We're okay for him.
Okay, good afternoon. Those that are still standing, we got seats up front, so don't hesitate to come on and fill the seats. It's great to have all of you in this room after having your names on a couple sheets of paper and trying to bring this group together. I'm Gary Gereffi. I'm the director of the Center on Globalization, Governance, and Competitiveness at Duke, also teaching sociology. And together with Fritz Mayer, who's a professor in Sanford School of Public Policy, we want to welcome you all to Duke and to this Duke Global Summit that we've organized. I really want to thank everybody for making the effort to be here. I've heard 5 times already today, that is a great group of people that you're bringing here. What an incredible, accomplished set of folks. Well, on the organizing side, as you know, when you get that incredibly accomplished set of folks, your schedules are way busier than the norm. So to try to coordinate and get all of you here on the same dates, it's a testimony to your own interest in being here. And it's also a testimony to the organizing staff. Everybody who's done these big meetings knows that it's a team sport. And we have a particularly good, dedicated team of people who have helped us pull this together. So right at the very beginning, let me mention Stacy Frederick, Andy Hull, Will Goldsmith, Jack Daly, and Mike Henson. Could you guys all just stand up? I see 3 of them are standing in the back. And I must give a double note of thanks to Stacy, because besides helping to coordinate the logistics, she also put together the website for the Duke Global Summit. And as you know, this is something that we've already started to use to pull together some of the publications and reports that a lot of your organizations are doing related to global value chains. And for the individuals that are here, we want to, we're linking CVs, bios, but after the meeting, we're gonna have short interviews with everybody here. You've got a schedule, I guess, in your welcome packet. And we wanna take those 5-minute interviews, and we'll also link them to the website. And also events like this one that are being taped. We did some interviews this afternoon with Pascal Lamy and Annabelle Gonzalez. Those will also be part of the website. So this website will continue to grow. And we want it to sort of be a one-stop shop, so that if people want to know what these different organizations are doing related to global value chains, this website growing out of this meeting would be a place to go. So Fritz and I are just in the welcoming part of the evening session, and then we're going to turn to a panel after this. But let me just reiterate for all of you what the goal of bringing you together was. We really wanted to facilitate both an informative and a constructive dialogue of two groups of people. One set of people are people that are lead policymakers in international organizations that are dealing in different ways with the global economy and development and trade and investment. And that's a very heterogeneous group of organizations that include groups that have economic mission objectives. Some of the organizations focus on social issues, others on environmental issues. But all of the organizations that we invited are dealing in one way or another with globalization, and in particular global value chains, as a way to talk about this globalization and to shape your own development policies. And those are changing very rapidly, and that's part of what we want to capture in the meeting. How your organization's relationship to the global economy, and in particular to your client countries, how that's changing and where you see yourself now. The second group of people we wanted to bring together are leading academics and researchers who have been focusing on global value chains. So being here at Duke University, this is a place where we've had a chance to do that in the past, but we've got a really, really good group of scholars that are also working on global value chains. And so by bringing these two groups together, the representatives of these international organizations, and I must say, we could have probably doubled it in terms of organizations that are interested in working in these areas, but we wanted to prioritize and bring in this group first and the scholars. We hope that this will be I think it's a unique meeting of any of the ones that I've been to. I don't think both groups of people have come together, and I haven't seen this range of international organizations brought together in the same place to talk about some of these issues. So we want to take advantage of you being here over the next couple of days and try to have a really useful discussion. Fritz will talk in a couple of minutes about the format we've tried to lay out for this Duke Global Summit. But what I want to mention before turning it over to Fritz is a question of why Duke? You know, what's our comparative advantage in holding a meeting like this here at Duke? And I think there are at least three themes or reasons why Duke is a particularly good place to do this. And two of them turn around anniversaries of sorts. This year is actually the 20th anniversary of the publication of Commodity Chains and Global Capitalism. Now, that's a book that came out of a Duke conference in 1992. The book was published in 1994, and it's often pointed to as the start of what later became this Global Value Chains research program. And I didn't think much of this 20-year anniversary till I started getting flyers coming in from like Finland. The Finnish labor organization is going to have a meeting on the 20th anniversary of Commodity Chains and Global Capitalism, and other groups are doing the same thing. And when you think back to the meeting we had at Duke in 1992, and if anybody looks at that volume, which occasionally I do because I was one of the co-editors with Miguel Korzenowitz, it's an amazing collection of chapters where all the authors were talking about global industries of different sorts, but it's an unusually broad set of industries, because even back then we had industries on horticulture and on Chilean grapes. We had footwear and apparel and automobiles, which are some of the industries that people associated with global commodity chains. But we had a chapter on the cocaine commodity chain, written by two anthropologists working in Bolivia who managed to survive that experience to write about it. I don't think it's an easy topic to go back to when you sort of laid out the groundwork. And we even had a chapter on services, the services nexus. And a lot of these topics, illegal trade or the services industry or different kinds of agricultural industries, are now very much in vogue in terms of their importance for development issues. But to think that back in 1994, people were already writing about these issues, I mean, that was significant. And I think the key thing for me of that particular volume on commodity chains and global capitalism was that it was a very interdisciplinary group of people. I think we might have had a couple economists, but most of these folks were social scientists, geographers, sociologists, political scientists, public policy people, all looking at global markets from the perspective of the particular countries they were working in. And the common question was, we understand that these industries are important in Brazil or Mexico or Jamaica or whatever the country was, but they didn't really understand the global industry side of it or how it was connected to the global economy. So I think in that volume, people first started to focus on looking at global supply chains, global production networks from a global vantage point. So that's kind of one anniversary. I think a second anniversary here at Duke is that 10 years ago, we set up this Duke Center on Globalization, Governance, and Competitiveness, which was an outgrowth of a global value chains project I'll talk about a little bit later, Rockefeller funded from 2000 to 2008. But what was unusual about this Duke CGGC, or let's call it Duke Center on Globalization, was that as a university-based center, we were often being asked to take tough topics and apply the global value chain approach to new areas. So one of the first areas we worked on was actually childhood obesity. The National Institute of Health was doing a big study on childhood obesity, and they said, we've got all the other levels of analysis covered except the global economy. Like, what's happening to global food and agriculture, and what about global fast foods, and what might be causing this childhood obesity pandemic? And we put together a few people, and we ended up having a set of studies on global food, agriculture, and nutrition that was a topic not well discussed then, but now is a really, really hot topic. We had another set of projects from the center dealing with the environment, which Environmental Defense Fund. They came and they wanted us to do some work on their corporate partnerships program. Could we help look at different industries where you could find companies that have a big environmental impact, but if an environmental NGO targeted that company, they might be able to change their practices and then disseminate those changes for the rest of the industry. So we ended up probably doing 20 studies over 5 years with EDF, but nobody at that time was doing environmental work. And to just take a final example, we're now doing a project on food security in the Middle East and North Africa, funded by the Minerva program of the U.S. Department of Defense. Again, a topic that's hot in a lot of circles, but bringing a global value chain lens has been a sort of a challenge that we hope, as we do those things well, have repercussions elsewhere. And one of the biggest things we have to do as a university research center, and we'd like to do, is put everything we write and research onto our website so that it's publicly disseminated. And that's a good thing, although it makes it hard sometimes to get the clients to agree that we should put it up there as fast as we want, and there's all kinds of issues, but it's been great from the center point of view to help contribute to this literature. Final point, why Duke is, I think, a good venue is that Fritz and I, over well more than 10 years, 15 years, let's just keep the number at about that, about 15 years, have been working on topics of global governance, private governance, and so Fritz, coming from a public policy background and political science, we've had to try to frame the globalization issues not so much from the development side, upgrading country-based, how do countries improve their position in global value chains, but what's global governance look like in terms of the multilateral system and the international organizations we have here, and what about the private governance that corporations are trying to establish in terms of their supply chain? So a lot of these themes that academics have been focusing on, fortunately at Duke we've been, I think, pretty well positioned to help push that literature forward. So I think Duke is a really good place for us to have these discussions, and I hope bringing all of you together here will lead to at least as fruitful a dialogue and set of follow-on writings and reflections as all of these earlier projects I mentioned. So let me stop there as kind of the why Duke, so hopefully you got some keys to why this is a good place, and turn it over to Fritz to talk a little bit about the organization of this meeting.
Great. Thanks, Gary. It's very exciting to see you all here. Welcome. Let me add my welcome to you. Some of you come from far away, so we really do appreciate that and the time that you're giving, and we're going to try to make it worth your while. I realized as Gary was talking that he forgot the most important piece of why Duke, which was probably obvious to all of you. It's because Gary's here, so that's the truth of the matter, and that he's been just a force of nature on these topics for a long time. I remember him first talking to me about this probably about the time before the volume was published, and I had no idea what he was talking about. But he is a persistent man, and over the years people started to listen to him, and he's really done quite remarkable things. So that's the other why Duke. I don't have much to add to what Gary said. We see this as a terrific opportunity to bring together an extraordinary group of people who may not always talk to each other, either across the international organizations that you represent, or and Lord knows the gap between academia and the world of practice is sometimes vast. And so we have this idea of a summit. It's kind of a grand title, but I think the caliber of the people I'm looking at warrants it. We're going to do our best to make this worth everyone's while, and so I'm just going to say a few words about why we've organized or how we've organized it and why we've organized things the way that we have. Our goals, as Gary laid out, are to have a conversation, to share best practices, to advance our understanding and deepen our understanding within the room, and ultimately to produce things that go out into the world, back to the organizations where you work, and into the more general public to help people better understand the nature of the global economy and the implications for policy for international organizations. So those are the goals. We've organized the sessions trying to maximize the conversation, basically. Beginning with the first panel will be a little bit different tonight, but all of the panels are we've asked people to speak for relatively short periods of time. We've banned PowerPoint. The idea is to structure things with most of these sessions have two moderators. We're intending to try to get as much conversation as we can during these times. There are two types of events. There are some public events, of which this is one. Second will be the Pascal Lamy's keynote address tomorrow night. And the third will be a Friday lunch panel with the academics, and those are all being taped. In the case of Pascal Lamy's talk tomorrow night, be live streamed. So these are public events, and we're encouraging people to come tomorrow night. The rest of the sessions are by invitation only. They're you know, Chatham House rules in the room. The idea is to have frank conversations and to facilitate the conversation. So there are two types of things going on. We will be recording audio recording of the conversations in the room of the invitation only, but only for the purposes of the rapporteur's report, which will be a kind of scrubbed rapporteur's report, which will disseminate only to the conference participants. We're doing a lot of taping of the events. We're also, as you know, we're planning on interviewing each of you in the course of the proceedings, and you have a schedule there of when you're scheduled for these interviews. These are short interviews, pretty basic questions about your engagement with GVCs and what that means for your work. The purpose of those, and indeed of a lot of the tape, is that we intend after the conference to produce a mini documentary, something that's digestible, that captures some of the key ideas the key ideas that come out of the proceedings, and that will be something that we'll project out into the world as well. So that's why we're doing all of this, all of the interviewing. You have an agenda. In front of you, we have our first panel in a few minutes. I think the rest of it is pretty straightforward. I think that's it for me in terms of logistics. Gary, is there anything else that we need to cover before we get in? I don't know if there are any questions about the format at all. So if not, let me just say we have an extraordinary group here. We're very, very pleased that all of you have made the effort to come. I think we're going to have a great couple of days together. So one more time, welcome. Thank you. Rolling now into our first panel. One of the major themes, or maybe the major theme of the summit, is this phenomenon, really, that GVCs, global value chains, have sort of caught on in so many international organizations, become of. To one degree or another, a framing paradigm for international organizations. And so what we wanted to do is have an opening panel that sort of laid out many of the major ideas, major themes that we'll be talking about more in depth over the coming days about the role of GVCs and their significance for international organizations. So what we thought we'd do, we'd ask several of our distinguished colleagues to all of whom have a great deal of experience and perspective, I think, on the issues that we're really going to be talking about. So we've just asked them to offer their perspectives on a few questions on their own personal encounters with GVCs, how they came to see this as something that's important, to talk a bit about the significance of GVCs for their work and about the implications for public policy. Just to frame the discussions that we're going to have over the next couple of days. So we have a fabulous panel here, and I won't give extensive introductions because, well, in some ways, most of you, most of us know each other anyway. Let me go in order that they're sitting here. We have Annabel Gonzalez, who it says in her bio she has had a long career in this area, but she's had a very distinguished career in the field of trade. She's currently a senior director of the World Bank's Practice on Trade and Competitiveness, which is a part of the reorganization of the World Bank Group, and heads up their work on global value chains. Was, as most of you know, before that, the Minister of Trade for Costa Rica. She's chaired the World Economic Forum's Global Agenda Council on Trade and FDI, and much more. I read somewhere that she was the hardest working member of Costa Rica's cabinet. I like that. I thought that was really great. So that's among her other accolades. Next to her is Andres Arro, who's director of the International Trade Center's Division of Market Development. As you know, the International Trade Center is really a leader in using GVC analysis as a tool to help promote the development of exports from developing countries. Andres spent many years in South Africa before that as a regional advisor to the Danish Industrial Fund for developing countries and in other capacities, and so he brings that experience as well. Next to Anders is Will Milberg. Will is professor of economics and dean of the New School for Social Research in New York. Will is one of those rare economists who deals with the world as it is. My apologies to the other economists there. Recently published an outstanding book called Outsourcing Economics, Global Value Change and Capitalist Development that I commend to you. And Gary probably needs no introduction, professor of sociology, director of the Center here on Globalization, Governance and Competitiveness, leading figure in the history of GVC research, tireless researcher and communicator about GVCs. So terrific panel. What I've asked them to do is talk for 10 or 12 minutes, initial thoughts. I may follow up a bit with the panel, and then we'll open it up. So we really want to, so we're going to try very hard to make sure that we have conversation. What I thought I'd do maybe is start with Gary, and then probably turn to Annabel, Anders, and then to Will. Seemed to make some sense to me anyway, if that's all right with you guys. So, Gary Gereffi.
We could stay at the table, and some might prefer to do it, but it's a big enough room that actually standing, I can see the folks in the back. So what I wanted to do is a way to begin to frame what we're trying to accomplish over the next couple of days is take those two groups that I mentioned, the academic researchers on global value chains and the international organizations, and just give you a quick sequencing of how I think the work on both streams has actually evolved using some simple classification ideas, because I think all along the way this work has been connected. I think it's becoming more connected now, and that I believe is an opportunity for us. So let me take the academic stream first. And I think I would divide the work related to global value chains into three groups that were sequential. The first group I have of research, or the first batch of research I've already alluded to, which is this work on global commodity chains, which began in the mid-1990s. And I think that work really was looking at global industries and beginning to identify who the firms were along that whole chain. And a key part of the global commodity chain work was this idea that no matter which country you're in or which industry you're looking at, there are usually key lead firms in that industry, often headquartered in advanced industrial countries, that controlled or orchestrated how that chain operates. And I think out of that global commodity chain work, probably the most surprising assertion that a lot of people began to elaborate was this notion of buyer-driven commodity chains. The idea that the literature on multinational corporations, which was a long-standing literature, and people like Ray Vernon that both Fritz and I worked with, and others, we're always talking about how multinationals in technology or capital-intensive industries spread their subsidiaries abroad, and we could think of those as producer-driven chains. Manufacturers were organizing the rest of the supply chain, often through FDI, or wholly owned subsidiaries. What was new, and what a lot of the work people were doing, was this realization that in the new phase of globalization in the 70s, 80s, 90s, it was increasingly retailers, brands, and manufacturers who outsourced much of their production, sometimes called manufacturers without factories, that were actually orchestrating these chains. And so in a sense, the global commodity chains work shifted a lot of the emphasis from the supply side to the demand side of global markets. And it began to unpack this idea that somehow retailers, brands, and manufacturers without factories were orchestrating global supply chains all around the world in a way that hadn't been seen before. And then I think starting to understand the implications of that for upgrading was a big part of that agenda. Around 2000, though, there was another, I think, big wave of research that was precipitated by folks at Institute of Development Studies at the University of Sussex. Rafi Kaplinsky was one of those people, John Humphrey, Hubert Schmitz, a few people there. And they were bringing together the people who were working on these global industries, the global commodity chains folks, with people that were working on economic clusters in different parts of the world. And in a sense, the agenda of this initiative, they had a 1999 meeting, was to bring together people who are working on chains and clusters and try to develop an integrated framework. And fortunately, the Rockefeller Foundation, who was at an initial meeting, decided that this was a noble undertaking, and they funded something called the Global Value Chains Initiative, initially funded from 2000 to 2005. It was extended to about 2008. A number of the academics in the room were a part of that group, Tim Sturgeon, Stephanie Barrientos, and others. And I think that, I guess, inside the group, we called it the Bellagio group because Rockefeller had this great Bellagio conference center that forced that hardship duty on us of at least once a year meeting in Bellagio. But I think that push really gave a different image to this research. And the name commodity chains was changed to value chains. I'll let Rafi tell the story later of why, partly product differentiation, partly substance. But it was clear that a lot of what was going on in global industries was about value creation, value capture, how do we measure those kinds of things. So that was another big wave of research. And then I think there was a third wave, and I'll stop with this wave of academic work, that actually began around 2009, and I would call it the Capturing the Gains project. Capturing the Gains was another big research initiative. I mean, the Global Value Chain Initiative brought together at least 25 researchers a couple times a year over a number of years. Capturing the Gains was funded by UK's DFID, Department for International Development. It actually grew out of some early work that Ann Postuma and Stephanie Barrientos and others were working on with the ILO around topics of social dimensions of globalization, decent work. But what Capturing the Gains did was it pushed this agenda from looking at global chains or global chains and clusters to looking at the links between economic upgrading, which a lot of this prior work had been focusing on, and social upgrading. And DFID and social upgrading means a lot of different things, but it was partly about worker rights, but it was also about labor conditions. And a lot of work then took place over the next 5 or 6 years. Cornelia Steritz and others, Mike Morris, all joined in, Dev Nathan. So it was a lot of the other academics that I hadn't previously mentioned are part of Capturing the Gains. So between those three projects, commodity chains, global value chains, and Capturing the Gains, the academic groups have been pushing to address new questions. And I think now we're at a stage on the academic side where people realize we're at a transition point, where the older models are actually having to face new realities, and people are writing papers trying to capture what those new realities are. So I think on the academic side, we're aware that we're in a transition point. Some people have talked about the post-Washington consensus era. Pascal Lamy, at a luncheon session, was talking about a Geneva consensus that he has coined, but we're probably post-Geneva consensus. We're, I think, in a period where people are trying to figure out what's the next set of key issues beyond where the academic work has gone. Let me just quickly turn to the international organization side and just mention a few of the key organizations there, because in my experience, the kind of earliest international organization to get involved in a lot of these issues was surprisingly the International Labor Organization. Back in the mid-1990s, ILO was starting to focus on projects like global production and local jobs. Werner Sengenberger was still there, Duncan Campbell and others, and the idea was, how do we make sense from a jobs point of view and unions and labor, the new reality of global production? And then later there was a 2001 ILO study on the social dimensions of globalization, which pushed those issues further. Then there was a sort of a decent work agenda. But even in 2009, the ILO was commissioning some of the concept notes that led to the Capturing the Gains project about economic and social upgrading. So I think the ILO was clearly a pioneer in terms of trying to raise these issues from the point of view of their constituency. World Bank, another very important organization in this, but especially post-2008-2009 economic crisis. I think people in the World Bank, mainly in the PRIM division that was headed by Bernard Hockman, but Cornelia Steritz was working there, Olivier Cataneo, and there was a sense from the World Bank, but we'll hear from them as to why, that the way the global economy was changing meant that they needed a different set of tools to address what constituent countries were interested in, especially around sectoral issues, looking at different sectors. And so the World Bank published some books. Cornelia and Olivier and I collaborated in co-authoring some things, and there's a lot of working papers, and now there's another set of World Bank economists, Dara Taglioni and Michael Ferrantino and others, that are continuing the World Bank tradition. But following the World Bank, or at least parallel with them, the regional development banks were very important. And our experience here at Duke, Inter-American Development Bank has been extremely active in trying to understand from a Latin American point of view how these new global production systems mattered for their countries. And even within IDB, several different divisions have been working on that. The UN Economic Commission for Latin America and the Caribbean, another very active group. So a little bit like Raul Prebisch and Paulo Singer and the people that launched import substituting industrialization in the late 40s and the late 50s, Latin America has become a region that often is maybe a little bit ahead of the curve on some of these themes. Although in globalization topics, East Asia and China are incredibly important as well. Maybe two other comments on international organizations. I think probably the central organization that's brought a lot of attention to global value chains has been the World Trade Organization. And some of the initiatives of WTO around Made in the World and trade and value added database, it's been WTO in collaboration with OECD and other organizations. UNCTAD has gotten into this. We'll hear much more about that from Pascal. But I think as much as anything, WTO has probably been the cross currents of a lot of these issues that they've picked up and publicized because of their visibility as a key international organization. So in terms of this kind of a meeting, WTO is absolutely central, and people like Patrick Lowe that were chief economist and Hubert Eskaith that was chief statistician have been instrumental as well. And then finally, another group of international organizations that I think has really push this global value chain agenda are the statistical agencies. Eurostat and OECD, UN Statistics Division, US International Trade Commission. I mean, I think once the WTO said that this made in the world agenda, or this reality, this new global economy was changing the nature of the game for trade negotiators, and it meant that you needed to have new data that were better reflecting this notion of value-added trade. I think that the China iPhone case, certainly that study pushed a lot of attention around how big the difference was between the gross trade statistics and trade and value-added and from a country perspective. But I think that the statistical agencies are really gaining a lot of momentum, and several of us have been part of a number of meetings. So I think all of these international organizations in their own chronologies have been beginning to focus on these issues. And I guess the question we want to address in this conference is why this, what we might call a convergence around this particular framework of global value chains, but also the sense that the term or the phrase can and does mean quite different things, not only among the different international organizations, but even within particular international organizations where you see different units using the term in different ways. So I think for me that's a challenge, and I'm going to stop. We've got academic researchers who have been pushing the research questions to address new sets of themes and issues, much more now, how do we link goods and services? How do we link trade and investment? How do we link economic, social, and environmental upgrading? Those are all the challenging questions. But on, by the same token, international organizations evolving very quickly. Just like I mentioned, Inter-American Development Bank, the African Development Bank has now been prioritizing global value chains. Their most recent annual report is about this. So I think the regional development banks and the World Bank are very powerful examples because of their connection to constituency countries. But WTO and OECD and others are kind of like accelerator organizations. So that's kind of my take. I think that's what's bringing all of you into this room to talk about these kinds of issues, these streams of work. So let me stop there.
Thank you, Gary. Annabelle?
Good evening. Thank you very much, Fritz, and thank you very much, Gary, also for inviting me here today. I think most of my professional life, I have been linked to global value chains in one way or another, working on trade policy issues or investment policy or investment promotion in many different perspectives. But it was probably when I became Minister of Foreign Trade of Costa Rica about a little over 4 years ago that I decided that it was very important for the country to better to try to understand better what was it that had happened in the country in terms of connecting to global value chains? Because this is a country that had transformed itself from a producer of four basic commodities, coffee, bananas, a little bit of beef, a little bit of sugar, into a country that was connected to global value chains in the areas of electronics and medical devices, offshoring services, and others. So in order to better understand this from a systemic perspective, I reached out to a number of organizations, of institutions, to help us better understand this phenomenon. And of course, one of the first ones that I reached out was to Gary here and the Center of Globalization Governance, Governance Globalization and Competitiveness, to ask them to map Costa Rica's participation in global value chains. And a number of very interesting results came out there. And we also went to the WTO and talked to Pascal Lamy, talked to Patrick Lowe at the time, and our good friend Hubert Eskite, and also asked him, what would you suggest to help us understand better about the role of Costa Rica's in value chains? So they recommended that we contact ID JETRO, and we did. And we worked with them, and we constructed an input-output table in Costa Rica, which has been quite useful in terms of understanding, again, better how the country connects to global value chains. Then we also went to the Korean Development Institute and also went to OECD. And also, I mean, and we reached out to many different places and built actually a very good knowledge basis to understand where what was it that the country had done and what was it that it should do in going forward in terms of upgrading its participation in value chains, strengthening this participation, expanding it, and the like. So when I concluded this job in May, and I moved to the World Bank, I became the senior director of this global practice on trade and competitiveness, and of course I was very excited to bring all this knowledge and experience to put it at the service of developing countries. And of course, I found that in the bank, there were excellent group of people who had been doing great work here under the leadership of Bernard Hochman, for example, my colleagues, Daria Tagloni, Michael Ferrantino, and others. So we began to think, how can we put together a number of things that I think are very where the bank has a comparative advantage. And we were thinking, all right, well, what is the bank's comparative advantage? And probably the most important one is that it can leverage a combination of factors at the service of developing countries. One is the analytics and advisory part of it, which is quite strong, based on data-based analytics that not only sit within our practice, but that encompasses everything from, for instance, the very famous Doing Business report, which, by the way, was launched today, to many other databases that that the banks has at its services. But the World Bank Group also benefits from a very close connection to the private sector through our private sector organization, the International Finance Corporation. And Atul Mann is here, and I know that he will be talking more to this tomorrow. So this connection to the private sector in the context of global value chains is also quite significant, and of course we have or we can bring access to capital to our developing country partners, be it through the lending that we do to governments, but also through this connection with IFC and the investments that IFC leads in many developing countries. So we decided that we were in a very good position to put together a new strengthened integrated offering for our developing country clients that could help us in a tailor-made way, could help us either connect to global value chains, which is an aspiration that, you know, in every place that I visited in previous capacities and everywhere I go before, countries want to learn, how can I connect to global value chains? Because they understand that this is a very powerful way of connecting to markets, and that by connecting to markets, they can bring about more opportunities and more jobs, which is, of course, what all of them are wanting to do. So the first point is how to connect to global value chains. Then is how to expand and strengthen that participation. Because, of course, all countries, and this is something that I encountered also very much before, all countries want to be doing the high-tech, most advanced research part of participating in global value chains, which, of course, is not possible for everyone to be doing, to engage in that part of the of value chains. But nevertheless, there's still a lot of work that can be done in terms of strengthening competitiveness in countries to be able to add more value within their own countries. And then, of course, there is this very important part of this, which is how can you make use of global value chains to promote sustainability, to bring about a sustainable and inclusive development. And all of this, of course, links very well with the twin goals of the World Bank, which are eradicating poverty and boosting shared prosperity of the bottom 40%. So we have been working in putting this this integrated offering together, and I think that probably my colleagues will refer to this a little bit more tomorrow. We will be rolling it out, I hope, very soon, and it will encompass work in these areas that I mentioned, and it will include the analytics and advisory, plus the lending, the connection with IFC in terms of the investments, and very importantly, which I think is something that the World Bank Group is quite strong at, working in supporting governments in implementing the different public policy actions to connect to value chains. And we have a strong team of people sitting in country offices that can work very closely with the governments in implementing a number of these reforms. In doing this, we want to work also very much with a number of partners, including other organizations, including institutes, think tanks, academics, because we recognize, of course, that that it is by bringing all of this, you know, strength together that we will be able to make an impact in these developing countries that we want to serve. So let me stop here, Fritz, and I'll be glad to take questions later on. Thank you.
Thank you, Annabelle. Out of the way. Thank you, Annabelle. Anders.
Thank you very much.
We need to work on this table.
Yeah, good evening, everybody, and also thank you very much for the invitation. It's really a pleasure and honor to be here with you today. Global value chains are not a entirely new phenomena. They were already around when ITC was created 50 years ago, also to be with some numbers, we turned 50 this year. But it is the case, though, that the phenomena has grown in size and importance over the time, and notably during the past two decades. The changing nature of trade flows has quite naturally led to an increased interest in international organizations and global value chains, and we also heard from the World Bank. And the organizers of the summit today have ensured certainly that the interest has also taken the form of an analytical interest, as international organizations have felt increasingly compelled to understand and, where possible, apply global value chains. As Fritz kindly mentioned in his introduction, I spent some time in South Africa before I got to the International Trade Center, where I also worked aspects of global value chain, but I think it will be correct of me today to focus on what the International Trade Center has done. We are, as has been mentioned, a joint implementation agency of the UN and the WTO. And we focus on fostering inclusive and sustainable growth and development through trade and international business development. And because of this focus, ITC's work has always been close to business. And as a consequence, the areas of supply chain management and value chain analysis have been of relevance for ITC for quite a while. In preparing for coming here today, I looked back into the annals to see where we started to do something that meaningfully can be labeled as global value chain work, and it was about 10 years ago. One of our first projects was a project to support development of the ICT-enabled services sector in Bangladesh. We are still working there within that sector. It's also been interesting to see what has happened over these 10 years, an immense development in that country. So ITC's work in relation to global value chains has highlighted four aspects to us that we find relevant when it comes to applying a GVC paradigm in the context of technical assistance projects or policy advice by international organizations. The first one is the holistic nature of the GVC work in that it goes beyond the standard trade aspects or players in trade. The second one is the role of lead firms, who are often the multinationals. The third one is the role of producer organizations. And the fourth, but certainly very important one, is the role of services in adding value to goods. So the holistic nature of the GVC paradigm, at the policy level, this has been repeatedly led to calls for more policy coherence, that is, to more coherence among the actions of different international organizations and to more coherence among the actions of different ministries at the national level. And as we all know, it's easier said than done. So the GVC paradigm holds, to our opinion, a specific position in this coherence debate for two reasons. The first one is that it highlights a wide range of policies that affect local competitiveness and goes beyond the traditional trade policy to include, for instance, training and innovation policies. And secondly, the GVC analysis makes it possible to clearly identify the different stakeholders affecting the value chain because of the coherence of their actions, is relatively tangible. It might be easier to bring different stakeholders together in the context of industry development platforms or DVC councils to coordinate the actions. So how have we as ITC responded to that understanding? We use it in our work, but combine it with other analytical tools to identify possible subsectors we want to focus on, and then we use the DVC paradigm to go deeper towards the level of intermediate inputs, both in goods and services, and also allows us, because of its holistic nature, to identify the relevant stakeholders at the national or global level. In recent years, we have been building up our capacity and our offer to develop platforms at country level that facilitate DVC coherent policies, and there we often have an inclusive participatory approach in our work. On the second one, on the role of lead firms, the DVC paradigm is close to business, and therefore technical assistance projects, which we provide at ITC, applying the paradigm and involving lead firms, have the potential of being very effective in delivering outcomes because the demand side is immediately taken into action or into account is right there. The potentially challenging side of the story is that the relationship to global buyer may end up in a situation where developing country supply is locked within a power relationship that's not to its advantage. So the way we have reacted to that analysis in ITC is we work together with lead firms, but in our work with developing country partners, also pay a lot of attention to supply side realities and objectives of the country. And one way of addressing the possible problem of capture is we try to work with multiple lead firms rather than one, and also strengthen the capacity of developing country suppliers to adjust to different buyers and diversify their offer to reduce the risk of dependency. On the role of producer organizations, these organizations play an important role as intermediaries, has been highlighted in numerous studies, the important role of institutions and in policy documents. So a lot of what we do is to work with these intermediaries, these institutions, within supplier groups or connect them to supplier organizations or relevant institutions. We also explicitly focus on strengthening what we call trade support institutions, like trade promotion organizations, producer organizations. And also here, from a participatory approach, we pull in stakeholders of relevance to strengthening DVC involvement. Stakeholders often go beyond traditional trade-related institutions, like also, for instance, training institutions. On a note on value-added data and on services, the DVC paradigm and its prominence have also played a role in encouraging international organizations to look into trade statistics in different ways, as we heard about with the trade and value-added database established by the WTO and OECD, the TIVA database. That has also helped us. It's a very important tool to us because it helped us to understand where to focus. In the interest of time, I'll just give you one example. It's from Cambodia. It's the only LDC in the current trade value-added data set. And it appears at first glance to be a standout success on the services front. The balance of payments tells us that services account for roughly a third of total exports, well above the global average, and that Cambodia has a net and rapidly growing surplus on the services account, which is basically a story about international tourism. But when we look, however, at the trade of value-added data, a completely different story emerges, a story which then helps us guide where we should assist with our trade-related technical assistance. Initial glance tells us that things look good still. Services value-added content of Cambodian exports rises to over 40% on a growth trend and well above their 7 average of 34%. But all of this increase comes from direct services exports. There has at the same time been a generalized downward trend in the share of services in Cambodia's goods exports, so the servicification element has declined. This is true both for domestic services content and foreign services content, but especially in every goods industry for domestic services content, which is a potential red flag, because it suggests that Cambodia is increasingly specializing in manufacturing activities with low services intensity, heading down the value ladder rather than starting to climb up the ladder. And this is a wake-up call, and it guides us where there might be growing deficiencies in the inability of local Cambodian services firms to compete. And this decline in services intensity, both foreign and domestic, for instance in the textile industry, has been a particular concern to us because it's an area where ITC has been working in the country, but the trend applies to any of the major industries in the country. So this is just one. We have other examples where we've used the same fine database to guide our actions. it clearly points to that global value chain approach can help policymakers and international organizations to see more clearly where the trends in competitiveness are heading, enabling much more precision in trade-related technical assistance interventions. So even when we focus on achieving export outcomes for the goods sectors, we realize now that it's often the services inputs to those sectors that really need our help most. On the second question we have been asked to address, what are the key issues for policy and governance? Do I have a few minutes to?
No.
Good. So the DVC analysis has changed policy and governance aspects around globalization in numerous ways. And we have identified a number of ways in ITC, which I would like to share with you. The first one, I think, is a fundamental that governments have a strategic role to play in global trade. And the DVC analysis have indeed given room for a significant strategic role of governments in facilitating connection to DVCs, moving up the DVC, addressing social issues in relation to DVC. The next one is that power relations matter, but maybe not only in the traditional competition policy way. The DVC paradigm has highlighted the role of power, very much so, but in a different way than the classical market power approach known from competition authorities. So rather than highlighting the role of power of buyers or sellers in a given market, it highlights the role of power relationships within a value chain, an example in a chain or networks of private enterprises. This may have implications for the way market power needs to be analyzed in global markets and for our role as a trade-related technical assistance provider. We have also been looking increasingly from ITC's side into the role of services and the fact that services intermediaries are now clearly seen as central to competitiveness in every sector. This has a lot of domestic industry policy implications, especially as services competitiveness is not exogenous but can be created by the right policy and regulatory settings. The fact that import intermediaries are now clearly shown to be essential for export performance. This counters for import substitution policy thinking, which has sometimes prevailed in some parts of the developing world, and also changes the focus from more mercantilist focus on exports to a new useful focus on internationalization. The fact that B2B trade takes the focus off the final geographic consumer destination means that the trade promotion organizations and other organizations we work with have to learn how to promote exports, not to geographic markets, but to the next business client in the value chain, wherever they might be located geographically, and some of them might even be footloose. The fact that DVCs have a strong region dimension, this reinforces the imperative of region integration, but at the same time, it needs to be remembered that many intermediate inputs will still probably need to come from outside the region, speaking to that, meaning the barriers to non-regional imports have to be considered and should be negotiated down, including addressing non-tariff barriers. The fact that we can now begin, as Gary has and others have taught us, to map not only the value chain in a particular industry, but also where the countries are positioned along the value chain, means that we can start to think more practically about what kinds of policy settings might be appropriate in the quest to upgrade along the value chain. And here, it's our experience that not all industrial policies are in fact appropriate. From a pro-competitive, pro-trade perspective, it's our experience that the best approaches are those who focus on increasing the services intensity of manufacturing via focus on talent and skills, on a focus on broadband infrastructure to enable whatever comes from there, and collaborative innovation policies. The fact that we are learning wild new lessons and seeing new competitiveness wake-up calls as we slowly but surely dig into what's in the value-added trade data. We learn a lot from that. This month, the OECD circulated its very first results showing that global value chain, as global value chain participation increases, income equality goes down. Admitted, it's on OECD countries, but still a very interesting finding. And specifically, backward linkages in DVC are positively correlated with income inequality reduction. I'll be the first one, I'm sure a lot of you will think also that measuring of inequality is a famous, controversial, and not very robust, but still I think it's an interesting indication. And from a services perspective, we now better and better understand that developing countries can participate in services value chains, rather than only goods value chains, and that these new opportunities in services outsourcing are equally open to, for instance, landlocked countries and island economies, small island development states, which tend to be disfavored in traditional trade. The fact that developing countries are turning to services much sooner in the development trajectory has been traditionally suggest that services offer a new development model with clear consequences for policy and governance and trade-related assistance. I have three more, then I'm finished. And from a services perspective, the first work recently done by the APEC policy unit, policy support unit, putting together the STI data with the TVA data, showing that the more services imports are restricted, the less countries export services. It might sound logic, but that's a reality. It's also an area we are focusing on. Again, here, the implications for TRT and services are very significant. Obviously, you can also listen to trade negotiations. We hear, being in Geneva, also from the WTO, some quarters calling for a plurilateral agreement on GVCs, and other calling in the WTO Council on Services for a GVC-related approach to services liberalization. So we also see it from there. So bringing all this together, the GVC paradigm shows us at ITC that we need to stop thinking in our policy silos vis-a-vis goods and services. There's no either or. We need to do both, and we need to do it intelligently in our TRTA. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Anders. And Will Milberg.
Thank you, Fritz, and just a sincere congratulations to Fritz and Gary for bringing together such a remarkable group and really an unusual combination of academics and international organization leaders. And I'm particularly excited to hear the non-academics speak and to speak to each other, actually. And I'm very pleased, I learned a lot already from the presentations, and I'm very pleased to see the IFC and the ITC here, particularly, who deal, in a sense, most closely of these organizations with business directly. And that's the subject of the conference is business, it seems to me. This, thank you for letting me speak on this panel, and it's a chance to kind of step back from kind of the details of empirical or theoretical work on global supply chains, and to think a bit about the theme of the conference, which is why this enormous upsurge of interest by international organizations in global value chains. Gary's history was good. But I'll tell a slightly different one, which is that the world of global value chains for decades was populated really like by a bunch of weirdos like me. And the idea, as Gary did admit, comes from sociology. It's rooted in Marxist ideas about value creation. It was adopted, as he pointed out, by scholars from a motley crew of scholars from economics, sociology, anthropology, political science, history, geography, development studies. I probably left a few out. So when the international organizations all of a sudden got interested, this bunch of weirdos started to ask why. What was going on? Was the whole world becoming weird? Or did the global value chain idea really have some importance for understanding the world? I think a little bit of both. And let me explain. What I'd like to say is that empirically speaking, it's clear that the world economy is now dominated by well-defined global value chains, and thus that the focus by international organizations on global value chains reflects that they are tuned into reality and are developing policies and programs based on that reality. I'm done with my, no. I'm not. There's some validity to that, but it's boring and it's not quite true. So let me first explain the appeal of global value chains as a unit for analyzing the world economy from my own perspective as a scholar, as a student of international trade, of globalization, and then give a comment on the importance of international organizations. For me, global value chains have a theoretical appeal, an empirical appeal, and a political appeal. And I want to talk briefly about each of those, the theory, the empirics, and the politics, and then conclude with something about this moment that we find ourselves in with this enormous interest from the international organizations in this weirdo idea. The theoretical appeal is that global value chains provide a linkage between international trade and economic development in a much clearer way than the traditional theory of international trade did. This notion of upgrading, which emerges in the 1990s, upgrading in global value chains, which has now become perhaps excessively referred to as economic development, as synonymous with economic development, nonetheless provides a dynamic framework for thinking about trade and development together. The theory of international trade, I will argue, is very static and was always sat quite uncomfortably next to the notion that free trade led to economic development. It may have led to efficiency, but the development connection there was always a little shaky, and there was a lot of we're good at hand waving, but there was a lot of hand waving in making that connection. That's, to me, just the tip of the theoretical iceberg, and part of the appeal of global value chains is that this assumption in the traditional trade model was that free trade led to so-called factor price equalization globally, which is to say profits and wages would equalize around the world. That's the theory that came out in the 1930s and 40s, and the result was that free trade, even in the absence of capital mobility, by the way, free trade provides a perfectly harmonious arena for the attainment of social optima. And that's the efficiency result, which leads to equalization of profit and wages. Now, other views on international trade, a classical view, for example, focuses on profits. And I want to talk about profits in really the rest of what I talk about. Profits, and it leads, an alternative view on trade leads to a prediction about a rising share of profit in national income. The profit share, if we think of income distribution in functional terms between labor and capital income, and its tendencies, something that Thomas Piketty's book has gotten us thinking a lot about lately. The classical theory of trade, for example, focuses on the role of international trade in determining the rate of profit, and thus the prospects for growth. So growth depends on investment, capital accumulation, and capital accumulation depends on profits, prior profits. So the theory of international trade, although Ricardo is the inventor of the notion of comparative advantage, which we now associate with the efficiency ideal, was really rooted in Ricardo's interest in understanding profits and understanding the relation between profits and economic development. And I think that's where global value chains are so interesting and so provides kind of a really contemporary lens to that classical concern, which is that profitability can lead to, if investment occurs subsequently, to the prospects for dynamic prospects for development and growth. So GVC analysis, global value chains, really lend themselves to this classical perspective and show how the profit share, for example, can rise simultaneously in the countries where the lead firms are and the countries where the supplier firms are, depending on the governance structure. This is something that was impossible to explain with that efficiency-based model. So the GVCs are quite subversive, theoretically, from my perspective, in relation to international trade theory, and they provide a way to think about trends that I think, contrary to the OECD study you just cited, I think are observed and are of increasing policy concern, rising functional income distribution inequality. The empirical appeal of global value chains, to me, I think it's been stated already by many of the speakers, business is at the center of the analysis. Trade is between firms, and these firms happen to be located in different countries. So the emphasis, I think Anders explained it much more articulately than I would, the focus on intermediates, the link between services and goods, And the focus on value makes us think not only about the distribution of gains from firm networks, but, as others have said, on how to even measure international trade. And so we've rethought how to think about value added in trade, in relation to traditional measures. So very important, I think, insights around how we understand the world empirically. More broadly on the empirical front, global value chains put the focus on the link between exchange and production. And again, one of the I think weaknesses of the traditional theory of trade was that it was all about exchange, and it didn't bring production very integrally into it. And the global value chain framework allows us to link production of value and its international distribution. It links globalization of production to firm strategies and to the governance structures of these production networks. So we now introduce corporate governance, we introduce shareholder pressures, we introduce finance and financial considerations of firms, and we introduce labor management relations. And all these bargaining arenas, all these arenas of potential asymmetries of power become the focus that this global value chain lens opens on the empirical observation. Thirdly, political appeal. Global value chains are chains or networks that can take a variety of forms, and this form will depend on the source of value and also on the governance of the chain. And the idea here, this idea of governance, has some very important implications. I just hinted at them and others also did. It points immediately to the institutional mismatch between capital, labor, and the state, leading to what Fritz and Gary have called the global governance deficit, that our international institutions are not built to correspond to the types of issues that the organization of production presents us. And I've always thought, by the way, and at the global value chain meetings that I attend, I'm often saying we need to take on issues of tax policy, corporate tax policy, et cetera, and I think that's an area, a fruitful area for future research. Secondly, the focus on governance differentiates global value chain analysis from input-output analysis that was referred to earlier. Countries are connected by more than just a recipe of production, but by private networks. And this way, countries are linked by these networks and are affected by the constellation of power in them. Thus, the consequences of changes in firm or government policy can be traced out simultaneously in rich and poor countries. So now global value chains are global in the sense that we did not perceive international trade relations to be previously, because an action in one part of the network affects the entire global network. So the GVC framework, I would argue, makes this north-south distinction less relevant than it was previously. One result is that the GVC paints a new picture, a picture of a new context for state market relations and development, and some people have referred to that. And I think this is, what is the role of the state? We've got international organizations here, and we've got former Costa Rican trade minister here, who really is on top of this question of what is the role of the state when production is dominated by these networks, where the actors are different than they used to be. And this presents a new tension, I would say. What are the policy implications of global value chains? Does it strengthen, does it renew the case for free trade and capital mobility? Because lead firms will drive supplier expansion, leading to economic development. Or does it present us a case for a new form of industrial policy that works with business networks, but nonetheless is focused on this upgrading process? And those business networks are, of course, foreign firms. It has to shift value, nonetheless, to the domestic economy for development to occur. It's export-oriented, but not strictly in the traditional sense of export-oriented industrialization. It's import-replacing, but not strictly in the sense of import substitution. So what is that framework? I just want to end on a slightly provocative note. One other part of this history, which Gary hints at very politely, is that international institutions had really lost their power and influence gradually over the past 20 years, and very suddenly in the last six. The World Bank has become smaller in relation to resources that come out of national development banks, that come out of sovereign wealth funds. Its programs are kind of overshadowed. The IMF really showed its weakness to us in its inability to influence the regulation of finance, macroeconomic policies in the run-up to the 2008 collapse. The OECD has been viewed really as unable to bring labor to the table with a sufficient voice. The WTO has failed to get a really significant new trade agreement in recent years. So the context in which the international organizations have embraced global value chains is also a context of crisis for the international organizations themselves. And perhaps it's a post-Washington consensus. I'm not sure the consensus is there yet. What I'm arguing is that global value chains are a classical idea. They're rooted in institutionally, sociologically rich analysis. And if we use them as just a way to find a way to put a round peg, this funny world we're in today, into a square hole, which is the traditional policies that came out of the Washington consensus, then I think we've really lost an opportunity. The assertion of the importance of firms of conflict over value production and value distribution, and the need for a new relation between states and firms. It's a moment to do some fundamental rethinking of theory and of policy surrounding development, income distribution, social protection, taxation, and financial markets. Thank you.
Not surprisingly, a very rich set of remarks, some provocative, thank you, Will. I'm tempted to ask a question myself. I actually have a number, but I will refrain from doing that. And what I'd like to do is open the floor for comments, questions directed at any or all of the participants. I think we have a handheld mic, so if you would speak into the mic, and I was told I'm supposed to repeat the question because we're not sure it's working, or it's picking up, I guess. But why don't we just open up, in the interest of time, let's go ahead and open up to the floor. So. I'll ask a question if you. All right, I'm going to ask a question. So this afternoon, Pascal Lamy was speaking with a group earlier. Gary and I were interviewing him, and he described this new world of trade, the new world that we're all talking about, sort of world out there in which global value chains are increasingly important. One of the great challenges in the trade world is that not only the institutions but the people who inhabit that world grew up in another moment of time, have been slow in some ways to adopt the thinking, and so it sounded like in some ways we're in an intermediate point between where there's a new world, what we're calling the global value chain world out there, a reality. But institutions that were established at another time and people who learned at another time, and far from complete adoption. So I guess the question I would pose maybe to the panel is turning it the other way. What are the challenges facing either the international organizations that you're part of or the academic community that Will and Gary are part of in really taking on in a serious way this new reality of trade? What are the challenges? What are the difficulties that you face in really using this idea, using this paradigm, and really altering, I guess, the policies that either the bank or the Trade Center or other institutions, other organizations have, or in Will's case, the economics profession, or the more generally academia. So that's the question on the table. So it's the other way. I think we're all converts here to some extent about the importance of GVCs, but what are the challenges we face in pushing this idea out in a useful way into the world? Now they're all thinking. You want to try?
Yeah. Let me probably make two comments to this. The first one is that I think from the perspective of the World Bank Group, the most important challenge was relevance, which is how to remain relevant in this new world where access to capital was not the most important element for a number of developing countries, where we had to also face, for instance, consulting firms developing knowledge in a very good way or academic institutions. And I think that part of the response to that has been the transformation that the bank is putting in place with the creation of this global practices that aims at bringing together the global knowledge and to facilitate the deployment of global knowledge across different regions of the world, alongside with the access to capital via the lending, but also via this, of course, very close relationship with the International Finance Corporation, as I was mentioning before, and their lead role in terms of promoting investments, and with the implementation capability. I think from this perspective, the bank is in a unique position of bringing all of this together. Now, there's also another important function that that I think that the World Bank Group has, and that is supporting multilateral governance, because this is very important from the perspective of our clients, of developing countries in the international scene. And in this, from this perspective, there is, of course, the concern of the difficulty of reaching agreements at the multilateral level. And we have been seeing this, of course, in the World Trade Organization now for some time now. Because of the difficulty of reaching agreements, countries have turned to negotiate in a plurilateral setting where a number of like-minded countries come together and aim at negotiating new rules in areas, for instance, of services, or to go advance further in the liberalization of trading goods in areas such as environmental services or information technology goods. They've also turned into the negotiation, of course, of this mega regional trade agreements. And regional agreements have, of course, been with us for a long time, and there are many of them that have been notified to the WTO. But the mega regional negotiations, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, are different animals by virtue of you know, of their potential impact on global trade and investment, by the kind of topics that they cover, in particular TTIP, by bringing together partners in different parts of the world with different levels of development, even within some of the, for instance, within the EU. So from this perspective, I think that we are seeing that new pillars of global governance are emerging, which have many positive things attached to it, but also pose a challenge to the 160 countries that have a stake in this negotiations, but they're not part of the negotiation. So this also represents a challenge to the World Bank Group, and the challenge is how can we support multilateral governance, particularly in reinvigorating the negotiating function at this level. And just to say here that I think one very important development in this area was the achievement of the trade, the agreement on the trade facilitation agreement that was achieved in Bali in December, and that we hope that can be implemented, because it is very valuable in itself, certainly from the perspective of global value chains, but also it is valuable in terms of reinvigorating the negotiating function of the WTO.
That's great. That's very helpful. Anybody else want to tackle this, or then we'll open to the audience? Yes. Anderson and Gary.
Thanks. Yeah, I just see compared to the World Bank is a totally different ballgame. We are much, much smaller. I think Pascal Lamy once called us a boutique organization, and that's probably what we are. Mm-hmm. 280 people compared to the many thousands of the World Bank. So the world from our perspective looks a bit different, but it's nevertheless also challenging to us to adjust our practices to a global value chain perspective. And why that? Our old motto was export impact for good. That doesn't really gel well with a global value chain. So we're about to rethinking what do we do for international business development for good, so considering imports, exports, investments, and so on. And I think one of the things that impact the UN system and related organizations is also a historic division of labor among us. Trade, investments, labor, education. While, as we have spoken to this evening, it all deals in global value chain, but we still have these silos of expertise, of ways of doing things, of ways of delivering assistance, technical assistance in one way. One thing that's also on our mind very much for the moment is this servicification. We have traditionally very much been working in low-income countries, small island development states, landlocked countries, sub-Saharan Africa, so a strong focus on agribusiness. But even there, one way of adding value to simple produce like a mango is all the services around it, the efficient services around it, the sorting, the washing, the labeling, the packaging, the cold storage, the transport, all that. So to understand this of what does it take to move up pre- or post-production in the smiley curve, this is basically about integrating services. So having an efficient environment able to provide these services is one of the things we are currently looking into, which is a bit of a new perspective to us. Others have alluded to this about turning GVCs into factories of development, or factories for development. So how to have a social perspective linked to an economic development perspective. It's also something that we work on very hard, and it's again far easier said than done. And then as what Annabelle also alluded to, the focus on trade costs, the Bali agreement, so this focus on with the splitting of a production among many countries, but often particularly in more sophisticated value chains, that these issues of trade costs and issues of crossing borders and related, for instance, also non-tariff measures, multiply and become really the sand in the machinery that could otherwise make GVCs run faster and smoother. So these are some of the issues we currently tackle in our world in ITC. Thank you.
Gary, quick
one. Just really quick, I would flag three challenges. One challenge is an old wine and new bottles problem around global value chains. The term is used a lot. But I think it means very different things, as I mentioned, between and within organizations. And I think the real tension is between some meanings of global value chains that are still quite close to neoclassical economic conceptions about facilitating trade, improving logistics, reducing customs hang-ups. And if you think about that vision of global value chains, say World Economic Forum, World Bank, other organizations, logistics companies, that's still very much trade for trade's sake and making trade faster, and there might be trickle-down effects to GDP growth. But there's another very different view of global value chains from a developmentalist perspective. The people that are working inside countries that are not so much concerned about trade at borders, but what's going on inside borders. And I think within global value chains, we see both, I mean, let's just say those are poles of a continuum, and we see lots of research, but I think there's a tension there. There's a big tension of what global value chains means and what are the most important policy implications. Second challenge, I think, is a big countries versus small countries problem that we've always had. Big countries, the emerging economies, the BRICS plus another 10 or 11 of large countries, as they look at the world economy over the last decade, I think they're response to the economic crisis of 2008-2009 is largely turn inward. They can develop their domestic economies more fully. They can move up value chains inside their country. They can create their own lead firms. So they've got a strategy for moving forward that does turn around things that we'd think about as industrial policy or productive policy. It might be 21st century industrial policy and not 1970s industrial policy, but it's still a role that big countries can play with strong governments, but most of the economies in the world are very small. And so I think when you look at the Central American countries or the sub-Saharan African countries minus South Africa or the Caribbean countries, from a value chain point of view, their big problem is they aren't big enough to to have functional upgrading. And we know that the way global value chains work, the way big buyers work, is when they place orders with countries, they want to have one-stop shop. They want to be able to have a lot of different functions taking place in the same, with the same order. So I think one of the challenges is, can we think about the role of regional integration, not just regional value chains, but regional integration from the supply side rather than the demand side? Traditional views of regional integration was about market access. But I think when you look at a Central American case, studies that, let's say, Jen Baer and Stacy Frederick and I were doing on Nicaragua, where they have a lot of apparel exports but no textile inputs. But there are textiles in Honduras, or there are textiles in Guatemala. So regionally, you might be able to create a more integrated value chain from a small country point of view. But that's a whole different way of thinking about regional integration. And here I think the regional development banks, IDB, African Development Bank, can play maybe a major role in helping not only rethink that, but provide financing. And the final challenge, it's been brought up a couple of times, these concepts, sustainable development, inclusive development, and shared prosperity. Everybody recognizes that those are keys if you wanted to spread the gains to the least advantaged groups in a country. But saying it and pulling it off are very different things. And I think we're still at the very beginning in terms of the policy tools or the actual best practices we can point to show how do you take smallholders or SMEs and make them integrated parts of value chains.
Right. Are we at Cornelia?
Now we've got a lot of hands.
Now you got hands up. You just need to wait a bit. That was great. That was terrific.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. I wanted to base my comment on Gary's last sentence in his statement, where you said you see that there's a convergence. But now somehow you questioned a little bit this statement. Because I think I would totally agree. I mean, there's clearly a convergence in seeing that global trade is organized very differently today than 30 or even 20 years ago. And I think there's also a clear convergence that we need different type of data to understand this. This whole debate about trade and value added, and there have been important improvements in this direction. But I think, and there I agree with what you just said now, there's less a convergence on the approach used and also the theoretical concepts used among academics, but also within international organizations. And related to this, there are also quite divergent, I think, policy recommendations coming out from different type of global value chain work, from academic work, but also from international organization strategies, and also within concrete development interventions or projects. And I just want to highlight five areas that have been mentioned here that I think should be also discussed in the next 2 days. I mean, one is the important question of power asymmetries and the ambivalent role of lead firms. On the one side, supporting upgrading, but also having quite different interests than supplier firms and supplier countries when it comes to several issues, like, for example, technology transfer, local content, or tax policies. The second point is the importance of institutional context and policy that was mentioned by all of you. And there's some work which you mentioned now, where there's a strong focus on, because of value chains, we now need even more liberalization, focus on trade facilitation, focus on business enabling environment. But on the other side, we also see important discussions on new industrial policy and how industrial policy can be linked to trade policy. And also the question, is there still policy space for industrial policy with like bilateral investment treaties, trade agreements, etc.? So the crucial question that Will also pointed out, what is the role of the state and which policy space is there and is necessary for not only integrating, but integrating in a successful way in value chains. And the third point is, and you also mentioned this now, it's really this shifting end market story that Gereffi talked a lot, and the importance of regional value chains, regional markets, emerging markets, and also domestic markets, that I think leads to new opportunities, but also risks and different requirements and also policy contexts. A fourth important point, there's a strong focus on economic upgrading, and I think Will, you hinted a little bit to this. On the one side, economic upgrading is often, in some work, now also seen more static, with a focus on only process and product upgrading. And the critical question of functional upgrading, and specifically how this relates to structural change and dynamic comparative competitive advantage, is lost. But I think this is a crucial aspect of the dynamic economic upgrading concept. And related to this, and I think you pointed out that this is the question also if economic upgrading also leads to the gains, which is, it is often perceived, like higher profits or more security. And when all countries do the same, I mean, then we have a fallacy of composition, so not all countries can do the same. So the question is really, is economic upgrading the best concept, or do we need to refine our concept of economic upgrading, and how can it be linked or not directly to economic development and uneven development? And the last point is that the importance of economic but also social, gender, environmental issues, I think, is recognized. Mm-hmm. But many work very often still focuses on how global value chains impact more passively on these issues. But it's also crucial to understand how these more social issues also impact global value chains and how they are structured. And I mean, Stephanie has done a lot of work on how gender, social issues actively structure global value chains and production networks. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I think that was six, but that was terrific. Thank you. Thanks, Cornelius. So that was more a comment, I think. So we have several people. I had Stephanie, and then here, yes. No, we have a lot of hands now. So I need to collect. What we're going to do, in the interest of time, we'll collect a few because it's. Yeah. We'll do that. So Tim, I know. So Stephanie.
Carlo.
Tim. I've got a few. Oh, yes. All right. We're going to let me have a list here.
Stephanie Barrientos, University of Manchester. Yeah, I just wanted to, some great contributions. Many thanks. And I just want to pick up on one thing that got briefly mentioned, but I think probably didn't quite get enough mention, which is this issue of private standards. And I think I should just say before I kick off, I do a lot of work with the private sector, with companies, particularly right down in the base of their value chains. What's going on in places they don't get to quite often. And I think a kind of big kind of vacuum, as well as the vacuum that kind of was being talked about in relation to 2008, is that because the world was changing and the international institutions weren't changing, was that effectively who was setting the rules of the game? It was private companies with very little discussion. And being in private sector fora, I was amazed how few policy people were there, were able to communicate at all. I think that's beginning to change. There was an assumption, particularly in relation to the social and environment issues, on the part of companies that they themselves could have codes of conduct, certification, et cetera, et cetera. And all the problems that they came up with, they were beginning to encounter, and often were put under pressure by civil society organizations to address, such as labor standards, environmental degradation, et cetera. There was an assumption that they themselves could solve the problem with a code or a certificate, et cetera. And I do think that we're now actually at a new juncture, because the companies themselves are realizing that they've thrown, in some cases, millions and millions and millions of dollars at certification, trying to raise labor standards in their supply chains, trying to enhance the sustainability of the quality of the agro-food products they produce, that actually they've not really got very far. Yeah. And there are a couple of obvious examples. One was Rana Plaza. I mean, you don't even want to begin to add up the auditing costs that have gone on in Bangladesh on labor standards. And then suddenly 1,400 workers get killed almost overnight, having been forced back into a factory. That was a massive wake-up call on the part of the companies. The other obvious one for my own work, is I'm very involved with, is this issue of cocoa. For so many years, the price of cocoa went down, and so many problems with poor yields, etc. Amajaro produced the prediction that by 2020 there will be a 1 million ton shortage of cocoa. That sent an absolute shockwave through the chocolate manufacturers. And they've been running around for many, many years trying to enhance sustainability. They've thrown large sums of money, Mondelez, $400 million it's thrown at trying to enhance sustainability in the cocoa supply chain, but they realize that they face major problems. We're now at a juncture where the private sector is looking to the policy community, to governments and to international organizations, because they realize they can't do it alone. So I think we are at a new juncture now, but really these issues of social, environmental sustainability are absolutely key, and especially the future resilience of supply chains depends on it.
All right, thanks Stephanie. So we had Carlo, then Tim, I have Mike, and I'm sorry, I don't know everyone's names yet, so I'm my apologies, but we have here.
Thank you. I'm Carlo Pietrobelli from the IDB. Thank you for the great start. I mean, it's amazing how we started, and we're just warming up.
Yeah.
Thinking maybe in terms of the policies and what value chain oriented or related or relevant policy is, and then whenever I try to explain it to my colleagues or friends, is try to make it simple and say it's essentially getting access to these chains and these buyers, and then trying to benefit. So this, on the one hand, this idea of attracting and facilitating trade, the logistics, all the infrastructure related to that, and at the same time, this opens an avenue, this opens an opportunity, then how do you get the benefits out of that? How do you actually exploit that? How do you manage to have the firms actually capable of getting access and benefiting and entering into a mutually beneficial, it can never be mutually beneficial, but beneficial for the companies in the country. And let me come to my question, that is for colleagues from multilateral organizations as well as academics, that is the value chain and value chain policies are inherently multidimensional, cross-cutting. There's a dimension of trade, there's a dimension of human capital, technical skills. There's regulation, there's industrial standards, there's certification, there's metrology, there's infrastructure, whatever. And in the countries we work with, this is all split in different ministries. And in our own organizations, let me be frank, given the spirit of the... This is all split among different divisions within the my bank, and I guess other colleagues would agree. So how do we do that? How do we manage to get this comprehensive, multidimensional, cross-cutting policy through and make it reasonable? Thank you.
That's great, thank you. Carlo, Tim.
Tim Sturgeon, MIT. I just want to really congratulate the speakers for getting us started. That was a very rich and inspiring set of comments. I detect, though, particularly in the comments of Anders and Will, and also it was in Cornelia's comments, a kind of gap or a fallacy about, missing the word of ownership. And we have we're getting into shape international input-output databases, but we don't have an international, a global business register. So we don't know who owns the assets while they're going through these systems. So if you think about ownership, and you know, we've seen in many industries, and what we have learned, you know, that the industries are different, but in many industries, you see consolidation and big actors at every level of the value chain. So the fallacy I was hearing is that you have buyers and then you have all these little suppliers. Buyer countries and supplier countries. And what we're seeing in many industries is that you have a set of big global actors from the very top down to the middle, and that's really the new piece, is these kind of middle, the intermediaries, the big contract manufacturers, and there's always been big players at the bottom too. Chemicals and others. So, if you look at it through that lens, and you know the trade data doesn't tell you anything about it, you can see that you have an enclave, you know, economy, and where these, as Will said, the north and south divide is kind of less relevant because the north is in the south. And then, if you think about the kind of accumulation of profit without investment that Will mentioned, and you see driving inequality in rich countries. You see the south and the north.
Okay. Right. All right, thanks, Tim. I have back here, yes. Yes, and if you, I'm getting a sign, please hold the mic up so that we can pick up the feed for the audio. Thank you.
I wanted to speak again to what Will was talking about in terms of inequality. I work for USAID. We work, as Gary was talking about, much more in within countries and looking at value chains within countries. And I wanted to say, maybe start with who we talked about these networks of businesses, but who are these networks? Who are these businesses? And I was at a right after 2008. I was at a conference in Africa of, you know, all African countries were there, talking about rice. And I got up and gave my little value chain presentation, and they very kindly told me I didn't know what I was talking about, and that. They were saying that I was talking about private businesses, and they said, you don't understand that the government and there's no difference between government and these private businesses. These private businesses are the government. They are owned by the government. And so I think that, you know, when those of us who are international organizations, when we try to facilitate trade or strengthen the businesses in these value chains, to what extent are we aware of the political economy, and to what extent are we just strengthening the political elite who have the control, and therefore exacerbating the inequality? And I also say that because I work with a lot of ag economists, and their research lately is showing that in Africa that you're getting growth, poverty reduction is going down, but you're not getting transformation. In other words, their productivity is not increasing. You know, upgrading is not happening. And people are predicting that Africa will be able to produce only 25% of its food by 2050. Then I just wanted to speak also to Gary's point about regional integration. And I was talking earlier to a participant from Cambridge. And in Africa, USAID and lots of other donors have tried to foster regional bodies, regional integration, with very little progress. There is so much jealousy between these countries that they only want their own self-sufficiency. So I think that you know, the regional integration sounds good, but there's so many political problems. And the participant from Cambridge was saying the same is true in the ASEAN region, that they're willing to trade with African countries, but you know, issues with each other are more difficult.
Great. Thank you. I have Mike Morris. We're here.
Okay. Sorry, I'll just be, okay. We haven't got a lot of time. I'll be very quick.
I'm going
to
wrap
The problem with the success of a paradigm is that it tends to focus upon one particular aspect and ignore other aspects. So the key thing about global value chains is that buyer-driven value chains become critically important, and manufacturing has become, and Southeast Asia has become, the heart of it. And what Rafi Kaplinski and I have been contemplating and just written a paper on is to try and differentiate between what we call vertically specialized, which are basically manufacturing-based value chains, and resource-based value chains, which we've called additive value chains. Now, the reason why this is really important is that you can't homogenize the two, and that they have very different policy implications. And it's that question that I want to, you know, us to start thinking about, because for most of Africa, it's all about what we call additive value chains, in other words, resource-based industrialization and building linkages. And the demands and the requirements in policy terms are very, very different from vertically specialized ones that Gary is really focused on, which is all about manufacturing, it's about specialization, it's about thinning out. Whereas the whole point about additive value chains is to thicken out, is to try and capture as much value inside the country as possible, which has different policy implications. In terms of the way government relates to this and the way other institutions relate to this. And if we forget about that, then I think that we tend to get very excited about a critical part of global value chain analysis. But we make it less relevant to the problems that we face in resource-based industrial areas, which are actually large parts, you know, of the globe at the moment. And it's the only alternative development of industrialization alternative, which is how to turn resources and commodities into a form of industrialization through participation in global value chains.
So, thanks, Mike. I had Rafi and then Dev.
We should definitely pick some students, as many as possible.
So, and I should say we're already over time, which is fabulous. It's a great sign of energy. And I can see now that we're not going to answer these questions, but it's perfect because we've got a fabulous set of questions on the table that we will have 2 days to work on. So, by way of warning to the panel, I know Annabelle has to catch a flight shortly, so that's even more, and we have to drink. Eat dinner. Let's collect a couple more comments. I think it's incredibly stimulating, but I want to leave us hungry for more. With that, Rafi, I had Deb, and who else am I missing? I can't see all the way in the back. Whoever it is in the back.
Yep, you got one in the back.
Okay. All right.
I wanted to hear Will's response to Steph. Because I thought Will's final point was absolutely riveting, and it builds on your two work, which is that the reason the international institutions are now interested in global value changes is they've been rendered powerful by the power of capital. And basically, they're irrelevant. And what the hell do they do when the corporate sector is now entirely out of control? Steph's point was that the corporate sector now needs the state, because without the state, the corporate sector is unable to get their value chains to work. So are these different agendas between the two of you, or is this another example of governance at the global level being entirely controlled by the power of the corporate sector?
Right, I have Dev.
Yes.
Dev Nathan from India, Institute for Human Development. I'd like to take up a point that Will made about the link between trade theory and the distribution of income, and where GVCs can give us some way of looking into this issue. The traditional trade theory, as Will said, tells us that there'll be factor price equalization, which of course is not happening, doesn't happen. But what does GVCs have to say about the distribution of income? I think GVCs brings two issues in, which are important. One is it says that there is a link between the distribution of income and the relations between firms. The firms in a value chain have a certain distribution of income. Some firms get all the rent and other firms get only competitive profits. Think of the relation between Apple and, say, Foxconn. So that is part of the distribution of income at one level. Secondly, value chain analysis also tells us that the horizontal or the local relations between capital and labor within each of these nodes, whether it is in America between capital and labor in Apple, or in China between Foxconn and labor in China, that these horizontal relations are both linked to those vertical relations and themselves also have a role in it. So we have two sets of relations. We have the vertical relations between firms, but it's not just input-output structures. It's also bargaining relations. And secondly, then we also have the relations within each country. So I think it allows us to bring in a much richer institutional analysis of bargaining and institutions into the distribution of income.
Thanks, Steph. I had someone in the back, who I couldn't see who it was, but there you go, in the back. We have one last comment.
There's one over here.
I had a question for the international organizations, which was, in what ways would you say directly or indirectly are global value chains being used for advocacy, especially in terms of social development, like labor support or like strengthening local institutions or capacity building?
She works on gender issues.
Thank you. Here and then. One. Yes.
There's the mic.
Just over here.
Just here. That's good. Yeah. We'll go here, and then you get the last word. But then I'm going to cut it so that we have plenty to do tomorrow. So.
Okay. I'm from the African Development Bank. Our interest in this topic really has to do with the fact that we're looking at a continent that is rising and all this good narrative coming out of it, but with a very young population, and we have to look for jobs. And our interest as African Development Bank is really to see how do we use global value chains as a means to create jobs for the youth, and how do we upgrade going forward. And especially now that there's been a lot of interest looking at, we've been engaged in trade policy for a long time, but what has trade policy given us apart from market access, which we can't access anyway? So there's all this whole issue of, you know, what does it take, you know, in terms of upgrading for us to access foreign markets and also regional markets. But I think what is also very interesting is that most countries are reaching 50 years of independence, and they're asking themselves, you know, what have we really achieved and what should we be doing? So I think the whole notion of industrialization is very important for Africa, for the African continent. And I think there was a speaker who spoke about how regional integration is not taken seriously. It is taken seriously, I think. But I think it is the way it has been framed in the past, that there's been very little participation of the private sector. It's been a government-to-government agenda, and very little participation of what the private sector wants. And there's that realization, and we are now trying to change that. So in a way, if you frame regional integration within the context of industrialization and what it means for sub-regions and also for the continent, you get a very different response from countries and what they have to do. And you, so there are certain sub-regions which we've seen where there's been greater integration, you know, the East Africa region, the southern parts of the Southern African region as well. So I think it's how you frame it and how you frame the whole global value chain debate on what role the state has to play and also the roles of the private sector.
That's great. Thank you. And one last comment, question, and
it's
then
it's good for people to stand because they can get a film on better.
Well, close. Yeah, I mean, there will be some other one will have the last word. Then. Yes. My name is Ivo Havinga. I'm from the Statistics Division from New York. Great pleasure being here and having the invitation. Tomorrow I will do more an extended introduction. But the point that I want to bring out is that, and it was mentioned already, is that when we talk about policy, it will be very important for us to also understand the statistical implication that we're talking about. And when we look at the paradigms that are around trade in jobs and income and natural resources, there seems to be also a shift in paradigm in terms of the traditional conceptual sort of entities that we think about in terms of the unit that we want to measure, the flows that we want to measure, the classifications that we want to use, the registers in itself. You know, a traditional global register that everybody now aspires to have might not function very well if you want to measure economic control, which not necessarily is embedded in the asset sharing or the foreign direct investment that you actually hold. So it's a different sort of matrix and characteristics that we have to bring into the matrix. Now, it's very important when the policy community talks about these sort of issues, be it the academics or being the policy, international policy institutes, that we have a reference when I go back to say, look, this whole discussion has jolted the statistical world, very much so. We're very much aware that the traditional notions of a system of national accounts probably will not be the one that will be able to inform all that. We have to go what we have now included as an extended system of international accounts. What that actually is, to actually provide that information that is needed. So I would welcome if we talk about these issues, at least I will bring in the queue. So what does that mean now in the time of information that you would like to have to understand all these interrelations?
Well, what I'd like to do is ask each panelist to respond to each of the... No, that's probably not the thing to do. It is an incredibly rich set of comments, very, very interesting, diverse perspectives. You can see some of the tension points and differences in perspectives. It promises for an incredibly rich discussion. I don't know if the panelists want to have a brief last word, or should we just leave it there? Why don't we leave it there? Let's thank the panelists and all of you for terrific commentary, and we're going to have a great couple of days.